Recorded Books presents Why Sharks Matter, a deep dive with the world's most misunderstood predator by David Shiffman, narrated by Brian Wiggins. Introduction. In the end, we will conserve only what we love. We will love only what we understand, and we will understand only what we are taught. Senegalese environmentalist Baba Diouf. Thanks for reading this book and letting me be your guide to some of the most fascinating, important, threatened, and misunderstood animals on the planet. My name is David, and I'm a marine conservation biologist who studies sharks and how to protect them. You may know me from social media, where I am always happy to answer anyone's questions about sharks. This only seems fair, since I'm one of the lucky few who gets to live my childhood dream every day. I've been captivated by sharks as long as my family can remember, and I've known for essentially my whole life that I wanted to be a marine biologist who studies them. While most kids go through either a shark thing or a dinosaur thing, I went through both phases. In the end, though, I chose sharks. My parents have always supported this crazy ambition of mine, but I suspect they believed that I would grow out of it. Clearly, I never did. You might guess that an ocean lover like me grew up right on the beach, but I was raised outside of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. According to distancebetweencities.net, my childhood home was 368 miles from the nearest ocean. So how does someone who grows up landlocked become obsessed with the sea? I read every book I could get my hands on, and I watched every documentary I could find. We were members of the Pittsburgh Zoo growing up, and I loved visiting the shark tank at what's now their PPG aquarium complex. I got scuba certified as soon as I was old enough and convinced my family that many of our annual vacations should include scuba diving. My younger brother, Eric, was hesitant to join me at first, but I eventually convinced him that most ocean animals are pretty small and generally mind their own business. We both needed to change our bathing suits, however, after his first open water dive, when an extremely large loggerhead sea turtle rushed at us from under a ledge. Dad loves diving, while Mom is a good sport, content to read a book by the hotel pole no matter what country we're in. I've been diving on 5 continents so far and have a little over 800 log dives. I should briefly mention that 0 of these dives were for work. A fun fact is that you can absolutely be a marine biologist if you are medically unable to scuba dive. I know lots of marine biologists who don't even go on boats because they get seasick. Like all the cool kids, I went to marine biology summer camp in middle and high school. I spent 5 summers attending sea camp on Big Pine Key, Florida, where I took one of my first formal marine biology classes. There, I learned about ichthyology, the study of fishes, coral reef ecology, and animal behavior. I even completed a course on the biology and behavior of sharks. The science instructors at sea camp were all trained marine biologists, and meeting such amazing people only reinforced that this was the career I wanted. While attending sea camp, I met my first professional shark scientist, Dr. Jeffrey Carrier. Jeff created the shark biology course at sea camp years earlier and still uses the camp as a staging ground for some of his research on nurse sharks in the Florida Keys. Jeff is one of the many passionate, brilliant, and colorful characters you'll meet in this book. In 2020, I fulfilled a long-cherished dream of publishing a peer-reviewed scientific journal article with Jeff. I was even the lead author. When it came to apply for college, I finally had a chance to live near the ocean. I eventually chose Duke University, which has a coastal marine lab campus in North Carolina's Outer Banks. I ended up spending a semester and a summer at the marine lab, where I studied the feeding ecology of smooth butterfly rays, a fairly absurd-looking relative of the stingray. I also studied abroad at James Cook University in Townsville, Australia, right on the Great Barrier Reef. My college application essay was, of course, about sharks, specifically about going scuba diving in the shark tank at the New Jersey State Aquarium, now the Adventure Aquarium, with my father. I opened my essay with the line, "Don't worry, Dad, they don't usually eat people." This was particularly apropos because the tank's residents included large sand tiger sharks, which South Africans call ragged tooth sharks because of their large and nasty-looking teeth. I included a photo of me next to an extremely large sand tiger shark. Years later, I was speaking at a Duke-sponsored event for prospective applicants, and a student asked one of the admissions officers on the panel what their all-time favorite essay was. She responded by praising a piece about swimming with sharks, despite not knowing that the intrepid author was sitting right on stage with her. I still maintain that essay got me into Duke. After graduating from Duke, I returned to Sea Camp, where I worked as a camp counselor and marine biology instructor. I even got to teach the shark biology class that had so inspired me as a middle school student. I've since learned that one of the students I taught shark biology to at Sea Camp returned years later as the shark biology instructor. In between working at Sea Camp and starting graduate school, I took a course at the Bimini Biological Field Station, aka Shark Lab, taught by Daniel Abel and Dean Grubbs. Their book, Shark Biology and Conservation, notes that it is based on that very class. I earned my master's degree in marine biology at the College of Charleston, where I studied the feeding ecology of sandbar sharks. I worked with Dr. Gorka Sancho from the College of Charleston and Brian Frazier, who you'll meet later in this book, from the South Carolina Department of Natural Resources. This is part of the reason I love sandbar sharks. Follow #bestshark on Twitter and Instagram, and you'll find that I spent years talking up this underappreciated species while senior colleagues teased me for having a supposedly boring shark as my favorite. Why do I believe that sandbar sharks are the best sharks? They're one of the most studied species of sharks in the world and have contributed much to our understanding of marine life. They do well in captivity, which means they are the first shark millions of kids ever see. And I am living proof that seeing sharks in a tank can inspire a lifelong love of the ocean. And they've made all these contributions to research, management, and public outreach without having fancy tails like a thresher, fancy heads like a hammerhead, or fancy stripes like a tiger shark. Finally, I love them because they were the first shark species I ever spent a lot of time with, and because they are unsung heroes, given all they've done for us. I got to see more sharks during my 3 years at Charleston than in the rest of the years of my life combined so far. This is because the shark survey I participated in focused on smaller species and the coastal nursery areas they use. Studying lots of small sharks rather than a few larger sharks meant that it wasn't unusual for us to see a few hundred sharks in a day. I also worked as a volunteer diver in the South Carolina Aquarium shark tank during my time in Charleston, helping to maintain the exhibit and feed the fishies. I wasn't ever bitten by a shark in that tank, but there was a particularly nasty red drum in there. And divers had to wear hoods, not because the water was cold, but because the sea turtle tended to confuse ponytails with seaweed. I began to zero in on shark conservation at University of Miami while working on my PhD in interdisciplinary environmental science and policy. There, I studied under Dr. Neil Hammerschlag. I also learned from experts in turning science into science-based environmental policy, and I wrote a review and guide to all the available policies to protect and manage sharks that forms the basis of a good chunk of this book. I got to help train the lab's interns, reinforcing a love for teaching and mentorship that was first sparked while I worked at Sea Camp. Finally, I got to spend many days on the water tagging sharks. A great thing about living in South Florida is that sharks are there year-round, unlike South Carolina, where many species leave in the fall and winter. During this time, I got to work with some amazing species of sharks, including great and scalloped hammerheads, and even the #bestshark itself. My postdoctoral fellowship at Simon Fraser University outside of Vancouver was through a program called the Lieber-Iro Fellowship in Conservation Biology that focused on interdisciplinary policy-relevant environmental science. My supervisor in the Lieber-Iro program was Dr. Nick Dulvey, who at the time was the co-chair of the IUCN Red List of Threatened Species Shark Specialist Group. The IUCN is the International Union for Conservation of Nature, and you'll learn about them later in this book. At Simon Fraser, my work focused on North American shark management practices and public perceptions of shark conservation issues. I am currently a postdoctoral researcher at Arizona State University's Washington, D.C. Center, an institute that focuses on studying science policy and environmental policy. I teach an online marine biology course for ASU. My career has taken me on some amazing adventures. I've met some fantastic people, and I've learned a lot about sharks and how to protect them. Through it all, I've developed a passion for public science engagement. I have spoken to thousands of people around the world, including school groups in all 50 states and 19 countries, about sharks and marine biology. I answer thousands of people's questions about sharks in weekly Ask Me Anything sessions on social media. I've written about sharks for outlets like The Washington Post, Scientific American, Gizmodo, and National Geographic, and in a monthly column in Scuba Diving Magazine. To date, I've done more than 300 interviews with the popular press. I still love sharks as much as I did when I was a kid, but after 15 years of studying them and their conservation, I now know a lot more about how we can protect them and why we should do so. The goal of this book is to try and pass on some of that knowledge. Structure of the book. At any given moment, there is a shark behind you. It might be 1,000 miles away, but there is a shark behind you. And that shark is totally behind you. It is supporting you in whatever you do and wants you to succeed. A viral Tumblr conversation between users The Rain Monster and Fried Cherry Blossom Princess. In this book, I hope to teach you why sharks are remarkable and awe-inspiring animals, why we're better off with sharks than we are without them, and what you can do to help protect the alarming and increasing number of shark species of conservation concern. For those of you who are already convinced that sharks are awesome and need to be protected, I'll explain the many possible conservation and management policies that can be used to protect sharks, including many expert-supported, evidence-based policies that don't seem to be discussed much among non-expert enthusiasts. In this book, you're going to dive deep into the science of shark conservation. You'll be introduced to the latest science showing that sharks provide a myriad of incredible ecological benefits to the ocean and associated economic benefits to humans. You'll learn all about the many threats that sharks face and creative solutions to solving the problems those threats pose. I'll show you how to find reliable information and how to ignore unreliable information, how to identify credible experts and organizations, and how you personally can help sharks. And of course, I'll be treating you to a plethora of fascinating facts about my favorite denizens of our vast oceans. Throughout it all, you'll meet some of the brilliant and passionate people from the world of shark research, conservation, and management. It's been a privilege to know them, and it's an honor to introduce them to you in these pages. You'll also hear about my sometimes wild experiences as a shark scientist and my research projects. Although I'm taking care to fairly present all sides of some ongoing disputes about the best ways forward, fair warning, you're definitely going to hear my personal thoughts on who seems to be right. Don't worry about taking notes or looking up the papers and news articles that I reference throughout this book. In addition to listing them chapter by chapter in the book's bibliography, I've organized links to them for all of you on the book's website at jhupbooks.press.jhu.edu/title/why-sharks-matter. The website also contains links to videos or photographs demonstrating some of the biology and behavior of sharks I describe here, along with ways for you to learn more about the scientists and environmentalists I feature in this book, including their social media handles and links for you to donate in support of their important work. I hope that you learned something, and that you enjoy the journey while you do. Please direct any questions and or hate mail to whysharksmatter@gmail.com or find me on social media at whysharksmatter on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. Chapter 1. Shark Basics and Fun Facts to Keep You Reading. What is a shark? Sharks have been living for over 400 million years. They came through the great mass extinctions and competed favorably with the rapidly evolving bony fishes, and today they are among the top predators of the sea. During that time, sharks have been honed to evolutionary perfection, with a body that yacht designers can only envy, with wide-ranging sensory systems that military technologists would die for. From Steve and Jane Parker's Introduction to the Encyclopedia of Sharks. I'm sure that you're eager to get started, but before we dive in and turn you into an effective ally for the science-based shark conservation movement, we need to make sure that everyone is on the same page and understands the foundational material. That's right, it's time for everyone's favorite part of a new educational adventure, the basics, in which we start at first principles and define our key terms. Wait, no, come back, keep listening. This stuff matters a lot, I promise. Much of the later content in this book will make sense only if you understand the background material. Even if you think you know everything there is to know about shark biology and behavior, I'd encourage you to check out this part. As a reward for your due diligence, I'll sprinkle each section with some fun, little-known facts about sharks. Before we can talk about how to save sharks, or why you should want to, or what they need to be saved from, we need to start at the start. What exactly is a shark? Most of the common questions I get when I speak with school groups is, are sharks fish? Some students seem to believe that sharks are mammals. A few believe them to be amphibians, and many think they're their own group at the same taxonomic level as mammals and fish. Let's settle this once and for all. Sharks are indeed fishes. They are not mammals. They are not their own thing. And please note that I said fishes, not fish. The word fish can be both singular and plural. One yellowfin tuna is a fish. 20 yellowfin tuna are fish. But a group of multiple species are fishes. A group containing one yellowfin tuna and one skipjack tuna are fishes. So yes, sharks are fishes, but they are part of a different group of fishes than the tunas and goldfish and bass that many people are more familiar with. This split occurs at the taxonomic level of class. Remember your kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species from middle school life science? Tunas, goldfish, bass, and most of the known species of fishes are in the class Osteichthyes, which classical language nerds will know means bonefish. Osteo equals bone, ichthyes equals fish. Not surprisingly, bony fishes have a skeleton made out of bone, just like you do. In contrast, sharks and their relatives form the class Chondroichthyes, or cartilaginous fishes, chondro equals cartilage, which means that their skeletons are made not out of bone, but out of cartilage. Take your hand and scrunch up your ears a little. The hard structure you feel is cartilage. It's lighter and more flexible than bone. Among other things, this means that if you grab a shark by its tail, it may be flexible enough to turn around and bite your hand. Do you recall that I mentioned sharks and their relatives above? Class Chondrichthyes includes not only sharks, but also skates, rays, and chimeras. Chimeras are also sometimes called ratfish, which is a terrible name for such a cool group of animals, or ghost sharks, which is a friggin' awesome name. In case you've had a long simmering desire to learn the difference between skates and rays, while both are flat and sometimes called flat sharks by advocates hoping to get people who care about sharks to also care about skates and rays, the difference has to do with their tail and fin anatomy. Skates have shorter, stubbier tails, and their reproductive strategies. Skates lay eggs, rays give live birth. They're also in different orders. Incidentally, not all rays are stingrays. Manta rays, for example, are not. While stingray stingers are a nasty piece of biological weaponry, worry not, they can only be deployed defensively as a reaction to being stepped on. Which means that the story that Steve Irwin's untimely death involved being stung hundreds of times by the stingray that killed him is just preposterous. Stingrays are responsible for only about 30 known human deaths in the entirety of recorded human history, but lots of injuries, many of which could easily be prevented by doing a goofy walk called the stingray shuffle, which startles them up from the seafloor without giving you a chance to step on them and trigger their defensive reflex. Although some stingrays do have venom in their barbs, not all do. Some listeners may also be familiar with the term elasma branch, which means plate gills and is sometimes wrongly believed to be a synonym for shark. The class Chondrichthyes includes sharks, skates, rays, and chimeras, while the subclass Elasmobranchi includes only sharks, skates, and rays. A source of somewhat nerdy contention between chimera biologists and the American Elasma Branch Society. While skates, rays, and chimeras sometimes fulfill similar ecological roles and face similar conservation challenges, in this book, we will focus overwhelmingly on sharks. I do this for two reasons. One, I know much more about sharks than I know about skates, rays, or chimeras, and two, people tend to care more about sharks than they care about these other elasma branches. So, I'll meet you where your interests are while encouraging you, when the subject permits, to expand your horizons a little and learn about other animals. Getting back to basics here, sharks are cartilaginous fishes that are members of the class Chondrichthyes. However, sharks don't all look like the great white in Jaws. They come in an extraordinarily diverse array of shapes, sizes, and colors with diverse behaviors to match. So, how can you tell what you're looking at is a shark? What makes a shark? Biology and physiology. What we are dealing with here is a perfect engine, an eating machine. It's really a miracle of evolution. All this machine does is swim and eat and make little sharks. And that's all. Matt Hooper, played by Richard Dreyfuss in Jaws. Assuming that you aren't able to examine the skeleton and determine that it's made of cartilage and not bone, how can you tell that the animal you're looking at is a shark? Thanks to Jaws, the most iconic feature of a shark is probably the dorsal fin, the fin on the animal's back that sticks out of the water when a shark gets close to the surface. However, dolphins have a dorsal fin, too. Many a marine biologist has been injured while violently rolling their eyes at fear-mongering news footage of a shark stalking a swimmer that clearly shows the dorsal fin of a dolphin. Many shark species have two dorsal fins, including a second, usually smaller one, set farther back. Sharks also have other sets of paired fins that appear on either side of their body, including the pectoral fins, located about where you'd expect arms to be, and pelvic fins. One way you can tell that you are looking at a shark is by examining the tail, or caudal fin. Unlike a whale or dolphin tail, which is horizontally oriented and moves up and down to propel the animal, shark caudal fins are vertically oriented and move side to side. They can also be heterocercal, which means that the top part of the fin and the bottom part of the fin are different sizes or shapes. The most extreme example of this is the thresher shark. The top half of a thresher shark's tail can be longer than the rest of the shark combined. Check out the video on this book's website that shows thresher sharks using their tails as whips to stun prey. I shrieked the first time I saw footage of this amazing behavior, and it's always a crowd pleaser at my public talks. Like other fishes, sharks have gills, and we can see vertical gill slits on either side of their heads. Like bony fishes, and unlike mammals and marine reptiles, such as sea turtles, which have lungs and need to breathe air at the surface, sharks have gills, which lets them breathe underwater as long as water flows over them. These organs are just a little different in external structure from bony fish gills. This is a good opportunity for some myth-busting. A thing that everyone knows about sharks is that they have to keep swimming forward constantly or they'll drown. I've seen this claim show up in all kinds of places. But is it really true? Well, it certainly is for some species, which is why sharks that are accidentally caught by fishing gear are often dead by the time fishers try to release them. However, some species can hold still on the seafloor and pump water over their gills. In the southeastern United States, the most common and well-known species that doesn't need to swim constantly in order to breathe is the nurse shark. It has an unearned reputation for being weak or lazy, though, admittedly, I did once see a nurse shark sitting under the same coral head for 5 straight days. Shark researchers will tell you that nurse sharks are often the most intense species that we have to restrain and study. They engage in an alligator-like rolling behavior I've heard referred to as the death roll of death, which generates an unbelievable amount of force. It can take 6 scientists to hold a large nurse shark mostly still. In fact, the worst shark-induced injury I've ever gotten was from a nurse shark. I've never been bitten by a shark, but one time an intern who was attempting to secure a nurse shark's powerful tail lost her grip, and the resulting Indiana Jones whip crack meant that I couldn't sit down for 3 days. I still occasionally get phantom tingling butt pain when I see videos of nurse shark workups. Not all sharks respond to stress of capture in the same way, and nurse sharks represent an extreme position on this continuum. While some species die pretty quickly after being caught by fishers, nurse sharks are basically swimming tanks. And not just because their tough skin can't be penetrated by some of the surgical steel research tools we use to take skin and muscle samples from other species. I once saw a nurse shark that appeared to have been repeatedly shot in the face. Other than some mild scarring, he seemed totally fine. My favorite indestructible nurse shark story could also fairly be referred to as a Florida man story. For those of you who don't know, Florida man is a generic descriptor for any particularly wacky criminal suspect in the Sunshine State. It became a popular meme when people began to notice a high volume of unusual behavior from Florida residents. Some guy in Fort Lauderdale caught a nurse shark, put it in the back of his pickup truck, and drove it to a nearby supermarket. Then he slapped it down on the sidewalk and proceeded to spend hours trying to sell it to people leaving the store. Eventually, police were called, and he was forced to drive the shark back to the ocean and release it. Amazingly, despite spending hours out of the water sitting in a hot Florida parking lot, it swam away seemingly uninjured. While we're talking about sharks constantly swimming, I should also mention that the role that this behavior has in generating lift, which keeps the shark from sinking to the seafloor. Another difference between sharks and the bony fishes is that sharks don't have a swim bladder, a gas-filled sac found in bony fishes that helps them stay afloat and keep still without bobbing up and down in the water column. Instead, sharks have huge, oily, buoyant livers and generate lift by moving forward, with their pectoral fins functioning kind of like airplane wings. Incidentally, until we figured out how to synthesize vitamin A in labs, sharks used to be caught for their vitamin-rich liver oil. These days, while shark liver oil is sold for a variety of purposes, including use in some vaccines as an adjuvant, that is, to enhance the body's immune response, sharks aren't often targeted for their livers anymore. A petition went viral while I was writing this book, claiming that hundreds of thousands of sharks would be slaughtered to help make COVID-19 vaccines. It was nonsense. Some pharmaceutical companies use shark liver oil-derived squalene in their vaccines, but there's plenty available from sharks who have already been killed by fishers, and there's no evidence to suggest that hundreds of thousands of additional sharks would need to be killed to supply this demand. Let's go back to what makes a shark a shark. Another unique characteristic of sharks has to do with their skin. Dolphin skin is smooth. Bony fish's skin is covered in tiny plates called scales. But what about shark skin? Sharks have a fascinating arrangement of tooth-like structures called dermal denticles, which point backward, snout to tail. The composition and arrangement of these denticles serves a practical purpose. They help make sharks more hydrodynamic, cutting down drag as they move through the water. Some human swimmers even use suits that were designed based on this same principle. This backward arrangement also means that if you pet a shark in one direction, it will feel quite smooth. If you pet it in the other direction, though, the tentacles are sharp enough to cut your hand or tear field research clothing. Shark skin texture is the source of a running joke in my favorite science meme group, Wild Green Memes for Ecological Fiends. A webcomic by Branson Reese entitled The Person Who Discovered Sharks included the text, "Smooth lions are attacking me!" Reese later remarked that he had accomplished his lifelong dream of getting hundreds of nerds to angrily explain the real texture of shark skin to him. Reese kept this joke going for a long time, even inserting fake text in a textbook that claimed that sharks are smooth as hell in all directions. Through a preposterous series of coincidences that only seemed to happen in my ridiculous life, the comic inspired a song that features me as a guest vocalist. Amazingly, the song and associated meme, Go Team at Least 74 Practicing Shark Researchers, raised thousands of dollars for rainforest conservation. Most shark researchers I know have had some sort of negative experience with shark skin, which can cause something we call shark burn. One time, I looked down at a lemon shark we were working up and noticed that it had a clump of hair on it. That's weird, I thought, because sharks don't have hair. Then I realized that the shark had twitched suddenly, resulting in its dermal denticles scraping across my leg, taking the hair and a little bit of my skin right off. The noise I emitted next was extremely masculine, no matter what the interns on the boat that day may claim. Finally, what about shark teeth? Like sharks themselves, these teeth come in a variety of shapes, sizes, and designs. Some are especially well-suited for a specific purpose. The mako shark's long, pointy teeth, for example, are great for piercing prey. The tiger shark's can opener-like teeth can crack open a sea turtle shell. Nurse sharks have ray-like crushing plates that are great for eating shelled prey. As you can imagine, teeth can not only help non-experts tell a shark from a bony fish, they can tell you what specific species of shark the teeth came from. And if the tooth is black, as you often see in those very tacky shark tooth necklaces that are free with purchase at beach gear stores, then it's fossilized, which means that the shark died before there were humans. A cool thing about shark teeth is that sharks never stop growing them. Humans have baby teeth and adult teeth, and that's it. Sharks are constantly regrowing new teeth their entire lives. If you look at a close-up of a shark's jaw, you can see they're built like a conveyor belt, with another row of teeth ready to move into position and a smaller row behind that in the process of being grown. Shark biodiversity and biogeography. According to the latest edition of the field guide, Sharks of the World, there are 536 recognized species of sharks. They range in size from the dwarf lantern shark, which could fit in your hand, to the school bus-sized whale shark. Many, like the sandbar shark, hashtag best shark, have the particularly sharky shape you're familiar with from movies or from visiting your local aquarium, but some, like the angel shark, are flat and capable of burying themselves in the sand to wait for prey. Some deep-sea weirdos, like the frilled shark, are almost snake-like in appearance and movement. Many are gray or brown in color. Some are blue. Some, like the goblin shark, can be bubblegum pink. Some sharks have beautifully elaborate patterns of stripes or spots. Some are sleek, like the short-fin mako shark, which is among the fastest animals in the world. Others, like the angular ruff shark, have just about the least hydrodynamic shape I can imagine. They look like the ocean's overinflated footballs. Recognizable sharks have been swimming in the ocean for more than 400 million years. This means that the first shark was on Earth not only well before dinosaurs trod the land, but before trees existed. Though we've lost many species over the eons, sharks as a group have survived every mass extinction event in Earth's history, which makes the conservation challenges they've faced in the past 50 years all the more heartbreaking. While we're talking about ancient sharks, let me assure you that, no, the giant and ancient megalodon is not still alive. It is definitely super-duper extinct. People claiming otherwise are lying to you, for reasons that remain unclear to me despite a decade of refuting this really strange folk legend. I've received death threats from people who believe I am part of a global conspiracy to hide the truth about Megalodon. Once I even interacted with someone online who emphatically made the bizarre and obviously false claim that she had seen the US government rounding up and killing Megalodons, and that she had barely escaped with her life once the shark-killing soldiers spotted her. Sharks' habitats are as diverse as the animals themselves. Some sharks are found on coral reefs, while others, like the Greenland shark, are found under Arctic ice. Fun fact about Greenland sharks, they have been found with digested polar bear and reindeer meat in their stomachs. These are probably the remains of scavenging animals that drowned, but I enjoy imagining a polar bear getting slurped from below as it swims between ice floes. Some sharks live in the open ocean, where they'll never see a hard surface their entire lives. Some sharks live in the deep sea, where it's so dark that sunlight never reaches. The megamouth shark, a deep-sea animal with the world's coolest scientific name, Megachasma pelagios, which means the giant mouth of the deep, has bioluminescent gums that entice prey to swim right into its mouth. U.S. Navy SEALs jokingly say that you can test whether there are sharks nearby by dipping your fingers in the water and tasting it. If it's salty, there are probably sharks around. While technically accurate, there are sharks just about everywhere there's ocean, the implication is incomplete because there are also sharks that live in fresh water. No, I'm not just referring to the bull shark, which Discovery's Shark Week programming wrongly claims year after year is the only shark that can enter fresh water. I'm also talking about the glyphis sharks, sometimes known as river sharks, which live almost their entire lives in fresh water. Unfortunately, river sharks are some of the most critically endangered sharks in the world, in no small part because they live closer to humans than ocean-dwelling sharks do. What we already know about shark biodiversity is amazing, but it's what we don't know yet that many attendees at my public talks find shocking. We're still discovering new species all the time. A new species of chondrichthyan fish is discovered about every 2 weeks. Some of them get tons of media attention, like a new species of walking shark, so-called because they can crawl on their fins out of water for short periods of time, or a new species of dogfish named after shark science legend Jeanie Clark, Jeanie's dogfish, Squalus clarkae. Others are little known outside of science nerd circles. There's plenty left to discover. But no, that doesn't mean that Megalodon is still hiding out there. Unfortunately, the threats these species face are as diverse as their habitats and color patterns, which means that there's no one-size-fits-all solution. For instance, creating no-fishing zones is less helpful to a species that moves around a lot and spends limited time in protected areas. Nor is a ban on selling shark fins especially useful for the many species killed for reasons having nothing to do with their fins. Generally speaking, any solution to a complex worldwide conservation problem, simple enough to fit on a bumper sticker, is perhaps too simple to be helpful. Shark senses: how sharks perceive their world. Sharks possess an impressive array of senses that they use to navigate through the underwater world and to find prey. They have all the same 5 senses that people have, plus 2 more. Sharks' sense of smell is legendary. In some species, nearly 1/4 of their entire brain is devoted to processing scents in their watery home. Some older books even refer to sharks as swimming noses. No, that doesn't mean that they can smell blood from a mile away or that they can detect a drop of blood in an Olympic-sized swimming pool, 2 common myths I've encountered. In fact, whenever you smell something, it's because tiny particles of whatever you're smelling are interacting with chemoreceptors inside your nose. Think of that the next time you smell something gross. It's worth pointing out, too, that sharks aren't just smelling blood when tracking prey, but also various chemicals associated with injured or dead prey animals. And while you probably shouldn't go in the ocean if you're actively bleeding for a lot of reasons, human blood does not smell the same as fish blood to a shark. Sharks can, however, hear the sounds of a fish struggling or something mechanical, like the sound of a boat motor, from nearly a mile away. Their lateral line, a mechanosensory organ that can detect vibrations in the water, is sensitive enough to feel the difference between a healthy fish swimming strongly or a sick and injured fish for which escape would be difficult. Sharks have a reputation for poor vision. This assumption is often erroneously used to explain why they may accidentally bite humans. The reality is that, while the huge diversity in shark species means that eyesight quality depends heavily on which species you're talking about, some sharks have fairly advanced vision. It's just not designed to tell the difference between a seal and, say, a human wearing a seal blubber-like wetsuit. Sharks, after all, are extraordinarily well-adapted to the oceans that have been their homes for tens of millions of years, and it's perhaps not fair to blame them for being imperfectly adapted for conditions that have appeared in an evolutionary blink of an eye. Sharks can see better than humans in just about every underwater environmental condition, which is to say, just because you can't see a shark doesn't mean that a shark can't see you. In my opinion, the most amazing sense that sharks and their relatives have is the electric sense. That is, their ability to detect electromagnetic fields. Platypuses also have this sense, because what's one more random addition to an animal that lays eggs and produces milk and can therefore make its own custard? Some other bony fishes here and there also have an electric sense, but it's relatively uncommon outside of the chondrichthyan lineage. This sense is housed in jelly-filled pores on a shark's snoot called ampullae of Lorenzini, which look almost like the chin stubble of a 5 o'clock shadow. If you ever get the chance to witness a shark necropsy, basically the equivalent of an autopsy on humans, you'll see that a tiny bit of gooey gel comes out when the face is squeezed. Please do not try this on a living shark for what I hope are obvious reasons. You may wonder what use it is to have an electric sense. Sometimes prey animals hide under the sand where a predator wouldn't be able to see, smell, or hear them. Sharks, however, can still detect their presence by sensing their body system's electricity and can dig them up for a meal. This electromagnetic sense is also helpful when it comes to long-distance open ocean navigation. Not only are there no street signs in the middle of the Pacific, there aren't any landmarks. Sharks can navigate the featureless open ocean by detecting the Earth's magnetic field, which lets them end up exactly in the right spot after a long migration. Shark reproduction and life history. The whale shark, Rhynchodon typus, is a live bearer, 300 embryos found in one mega mama supreme. Title of a 1996 paper on whale shark reproduction. This is my all-time favorite scientific paper title, narrowly beating out Fantastic Yeasts and Where to Find Them. You're doing great so far with the introductory material. Here's another fun fact to keep you paying attention. Ichthyologist David Starr Jordan was the first scientist to describe the goblin shark. This shark is known not only for its bizarre coloration and long, pointed snout that's been described as floppier than you'd expect, but also for having the ability to hyperextend its jaws. Jordan's life was the subject of Lulu Miller's 2020 book, Why Fish Don't Exist, a story of loss, love, and the hidden order of life. While serving as the first president of Stanford University, Jordan allegedly played a role in the 1905 murder of the university's co-founder, Jane Stanford. Evidence suggests that he also helped to cover up her death. I'm still mad that this nugget of information got cut from an article I wrote for Sport Diver magazine about goblin sharks, so you can enjoy it here. Jordan was also an avowed eugenicist. Recently, a California elementary school that had been named after him was renamed. Anyway, back to sharks. The last thing I need you to understand before we can start talking about the threats sharks face is that their unusual life history makes them inherently vulnerable to overfishing pressures. Sharks have what's called a K-selected life history, which means that they have relatively few babies, have them relatively infrequently, and have them relatively late in life. This strategy has huge benefits. Any given baby shark is more likely to survive to adulthood compared with, say, a larval tuna, because the mother is able to invest more energy into each individual baby, mainly while the baby is still inside the mother. Baby sharks grow up inside the body of the mother, either all the way to birth or for at least a little while. Indeed, young of year sharks are able to fend for themselves from the moment they're born. This strategy has its disadvantages, especially in the age of human industrial scale fishing. If many sharks are killed, it takes a lot longer for their population numbers to bounce back. Let's unpack this a little bit more. First of all, unlike most bony fishes, sharks do not spawn. Spawning is when a large number of fish of the same species get together and release a giant cloud of sperm and eggs into the water. These eggs fertilize outside of the mother's body. Usually, but not always, the baby fish will spend a small part of their life as plankton. Even though most of these baby fish don't survive, it's hard out there if you're less than an inch long, the spawning process can produce a huge new generation. Sharks, in contrast, reproduce by means of internal fertilization. The shark mating process is fairly recognizable, even if you're seeing it for the first time. Male sharks have two sex organs called claspers, which are inserted, only one at a time, into the female's cloaca for sperm transfer. A cloaca is a cavity at the end of the digestive tract. Birds and reptiles, among others, have this as well. When my PhD lab had high school students join us for a day of shark research, sometimes they would say, "I think this is a boy, but I am not sure." And we would reply, "Then it's not a boy. If it was, you could definitely tell." Shark reproduction, by the way, is extraordinarily violent and involves lots of biting, which allows sharks to stay together while moving through a three-dimensional environment. Female shark skin is often twice as thick as that of males of the same species, allowing them to withstand the trauma of the bites. This also explains why we scientists sometimes laugh when you ask us if our research hurts the sharks. Because normal day-to-day life clearly hurts them much more than anything we're doing. What happens next is incredibly diverse by biological standards. Some sharks lay eggs, which sometimes wash ashore in tough protective pouches that are called mermaid's purses. Some sharks gestate their young in a yolk sac attached to an umbilical cord and give live birth just like mammals. Very recently born sharks who have developed this way can be identified by their belly button-like umbilical scars. Some sharks reproduce using a strange mix of these methods. The unborn shark grows within an egg, but the egg is inside the mother the whole time. These methods are all points on a continuum, and until 2020, when scientists discovered an entirely new one, there were already 10 known distinct reproductive strategies. Sustained single oviparity blends elements from single oviparity, having one or two eggs at a time in the uterus, but not for very long, and multiple oviparity, having lots of eggs in the uterus at a time for longer. With sustained single oviparity, there's one egg at a time, but it stays in the mother for a longer period of time, which means fewer babies are born, but each one has a higher chance of survival because it's more developed. Sharks also engage in something called multiple paternity, in which a female will mate with multiple males during a breeding season, become pregnant by several of them, and give birth to a litter of half-siblings, born of the same mother but with different fathers. Have you heard of intrauterine cannibalism, in which some embryonic sharks eat their siblings in the womb? Some scientists believe that this is a response to multiple paternity, aiming to make sure only the strongest genes survive to birth. Another interesting thing about where baby sharks come from is that several species have been known to exhibit parthenogenesis, in which a mother does not mate with a male, but is able to become pregnant anyway. She gives birth to a litter of pups that are genetically identical to herself instead of a mix of the DNA of a mom and a dad. This behavior has been discovered in aquariums, where female sharks kept in a tank without any males still give birth. It's also been documented in wild populations of some endangered species. It can be an effective way to keep your population's numbers up even if you can't find a suitable mate. Sexual reproduction, mixing the DNA of the female and the male, helps increase the genetic diversity of the species, an advantage that asexual reproduction does not have. Asexual reproduction also results in some genetic copying errors. Scientists have also documented sperm storage in captive female sharks. After mating, a female may decide that now isn't a great time to become pregnant and will simply store the sperm inside her own body until pregnancy sounds like a good option. The record for this type of delayed pregnancy is just over 4 years. You have made it through the introductory materials. I'm proud of you. Now that you know sharks are a diverse, widespread, and ancient group of animals with some amazing adaptations for living in the ocean, you'll be well-equipped to understand why you don't need to be afraid of sharks, why we're better off with sharks than without them, what's behind some of the threats they face, and what can be done to help them. Chapter 2. Sharks are not a threat to humans. Interesting fact, a shark will only attack you if you're wet. British comedian Sean Locke. Obviously, this book argues that humans are better off with healthy shark populations than we are without sharks in our waters, and that the benefits of having sharks around outweigh the costs. But implicit in this argument is that there are costs in the form of human injuries or deaths caused by sharks. There are also potentially costs in terms of shark depredation, or sharks eating fish caught by fishers, but this is still an emerging issue of concern in need of further research. Any such injury or death is a tragedy, and I don't want to minimize the suffering endured by shark bite victims or their families. However, it is important to keep in mind the relative risk of such a tragedy when considering policy solutions. As you'll see in this chapter, humans have an incredibly low risk of being bitten by a shark. Shark bites are one of the topics I get asked about the most during the question and answer session of my public talks. It's also the aspect of sharks that I enjoy discussing the least in media interviews. The way many of these media requests are presented sets up the scientist to be the bad guy. My first ever TV interview was on a Charleston, South Carolina news station after an adorable toddler was, very mildly, bitten by a shark. Saying, well, actually, shark bites are really rare and sharks are important and in trouble, seems callous when juxtaposed with a cute kid bleeding and crying. For the record, I suspect that the kid in question stepped on an oyster or something. I still don't see how a shark bite could have resulted in an injury just to the bottom of the child's foot, but I chose not to propose this in a 30-second spot when I had a clear script to follow. In response to the second most common question I'm asked, the most common question is, what's your favorite shark? No, I've never been bitten by a shark. I've been bitten at a lot. You may have heard that sharks won't bother you unless you bother them first. Well, we scientists often bother them, although we do so for an important purpose, following strict rules of ethical animal research. The first day my father ever came on a research vessel with me, after 15 years of me saying, no, Dad, sharks aren't dangerous. I wouldn't be safer being a lawyer like you. We had to cut the trip short to take me to the ER. This wasn't because of anything a shark did, but because I got careless around our gear and got a large fishing hook stuck clean through my hand. The hook was so big that the hospital didn't have the tools to remove it. A nurse had to run home and borrow a tool from her husband, who ran a landscaping business. I still have the remains of the hook in a medical waste jar on my desk. And a photo of me with the hook through my hand is now part of a government safety training video for fishers. But no, I've never been bitten. But back to why I don't like discussing shark bites. I frankly don't find the subject particularly interesting. There's an incredibly diverse group of animals older than the rings of Saturn, capable of countless amazing behaviors, critically important to the health of an ecosystem that billions of people depend on for food, and in serious conservation trouble. Yet, even given all that, the topic people want to ask me about is how some sharks bite people occasionally. Perhaps I can interest you instead in a...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.